warm welcome to this webinar on Consumer Protection Act 2019. A very good evening to all our special panelists and this August audience which has joined in this evening. Thank you so much to all of you who've joined on this event. And it's a proud moment for Suriksha Edu Skills today to be hosting this entire event in partnership with Manav Ratna University and Bar InVent. Thank you again to all of you who joined here today. Now, let me tell you that Suriksha Edu Skills is a new venture and it's almost appropriation of the pandemic era because we realized that how important it was to reach out the online content to the students who were devoid of education. And that's how this idea started. Now, Suriksha Edu Skills aims to cater to the online education customized according to the Indian requirements. We talk about employability with skills and also skilling with a difference. In the field of law, we hope to cover an extensive ground. And our latest course, which is coming up, is in the legislative drafting field. And I would now request Dr. Varsha Wahini, who is Associate Dean of the Law Department at Manav Ratna University, who will just give you a kaleidoscopic view of what all we are planning as far as law is concerned. Dr. Varsha, welcome on the evening.
Thank you, Neeluji, and thank you very much for allowing me or giving me this opportunity to speak about the organizers of the event. Manav Ratna University is, you might be knowing, is situated in the lap of magnificent and breathtaking Aravali Hills. With 22 years in higher and skill education, Manav Ratna started law programs in the nature of 5 years integrated law programs at undergraduate level in BA LLB, BBA LLB, and BCom LLB, along with LLM with specialization in commercial arbitration, corporate law, and criminal law. Under the chairmanship of Justice R.C. Lahoti, the advisory board of Faculty of Law is comprising of legal luminaries, and advisory board is guiding and leading us to ensure quality legal education is imparted and appropriate skills among the students are developed. Today's event is a testimony to our commitment to excellence. Continuously exploring ourselves and pushing the traditional boundaries, Faculty of Law is now ready to offer executive legal education in niche areas such as legislative drafting, competition law, commercial arbitration, insolvency and bankruptcy, corporate mergers and acquisitions, and taxation, to name a few. These executive courses are offered in collaboration with and on the platform of Suviksha Edu Skills in an online mode. We all are very well versed with the benefits of online education. It facilitates more and more people desirous of obtaining knowledge and honing the skills to do so from the convenience of their homes in a cost and resource effective manner. The courses are scheduled to start from next week onwards, with few of them in the next month and others in coming months. It would interest all those present here to check out the Suviksha portals and register for the courses as per your requirements and preference. Faculty of Law is delighted to present to you today an exciting webinar providing insight into the Consumer Protection Act 2019, featuring none other than Honorable Justice R.K. Agarwal, former Judge, Supreme Court of India, and President, National Consumer Dispute Redressal Commission, and Mr. Joy Basu, Senior Advocate, Supreme Court of India, in conversation with Mr. Shashank Garg, Partner, Advani & Co. Where on the one hand, digital revolution has afforded easy access to large variety of goods and services to the consumers, along with convenient payment options, it has presented challenges to the effectiveness of legal framework, providing redressal and remedy to the consumers. This has compelled Parliament to pass Consumer Protection Bill 2019 with an objective to provide timely and effective administration and settlement of consumer disputes. The Act seeks to replace more than three decades old Consumer Protection Act 1996. The new Act is more inclusive and exclusive at the same time. While the Act has widened the definition of consumer to include more buyers and users of goods and services, it has tightened the net for those who all can be held liable under the Act. The definition of product seller includes those who are involved in placing the product for commercial purposes, to include e-commerce platforms who till now were escaping by arguing that they were acting merely as platforms or aggregators with no direct interest or intervention. The liability under the new law may be fixed even when manufacturer or provider is not negligent or fraudulent. The Act seeks to overhaul the entire consumer protection jurisprudence by making changes in the process of e-filing and place of filing. For knowing more about the changes in the law and how they will impact in future, we have gathered here to hear the experts on this very, very pertinent topic. Thank you once again, the expert panelists who have agreed to speak on consumer matters today with us. And once again, I welcome all present here.
Thank you, Dr. Varsha. Thank you. Thank you so much. And you've given a beautiful lowdown about the Consumer Protection Act. And of course, in today's webinar, we are going to look forward to a lot of issues as far as the rights of consumers are concerned, how to enforce them. There are many people who don't even know the nuances of this legislation, what amendments have been made. So we hope to look forward to listen to all our panelists. Now let me invite Joy Basu, who's a designated senior advocate and independent legal practitioner at the Supreme Court of India. And before I just request him to start speaking, a few housekeeping rules for all of you. There's a chat box right in front of you, and you have, if you have any queries from any of the panelists, just write in those questions in the chat box, and we will take it up after Justice R.K. Agarwal finishes speaking up. So Joy Basuji, over to you.
Good evening, Honorable Justice R.K. Agarwal, President of the Honorable National Consumer Disputes Redressal Commission, Mrs. Dr. Varsha Vahini, Dean, Manav Ratna University, Mr. Shashank Garg, Partner Advani and Company, Ms. Vyas, esteemed colleagues, members of the bar, guests, ladies and gentlemen. Since we are 2 days away from the 15th of March, the World Consumer Rights Day, which is celebrated to increase global awareness on consumer rights issues, I must congratulate the organizers for having chosen the most appropriate time to conduct this webinar. What often goes unnoticed is that consumer protection as a first principle is not a new and novel concept. Rather, it has its foundation in basic ethical business practices, which can be found not just in modern day laws, but traces of such principles date back to ancient civilization. The Manusmriti and the Vedas are said to speak of such rights. These are one of the first texts to write about the 18 heads or titles of litigation and matters pertaining to buyers and consumers. In ancient India, effective measures were initiated to protect consumers from crimes and unfair trade practices in the marketplace, such as acts of adulteration and false weights and measures, for which severe punishments were prescribed for wrongdoers. In the medieval period, history shows us that some Mughal rulers had developed well-organized market mechanisms to monitor prices and the supply of goods to the markets. Similarly, even during the British period, the modern legal system was introduced in India and many laws were enacted to protect the interests of consumers. Since independence, we have had the Sale of Goods Act, the Law of Torts, the introduction of the Monopolies and Restrictive Trade Practices Act of 69, the Prevention of Food Adulteration Act of 54, and of course, the specialized legislation catering exclusively to a consumer, resulting in the Consumer Protection Act of 1986. Interestingly, India's Consumer Protection Act of 86 predates even that of a colonizer, that is UK's Consumer Protection Act, which was enacted in 1987. Today we have gathered because we are witness to the next paradigm shift in the realm of consumer rights, that is the Indian Consumer Protection Act of 2019. This act brings in place an entirely new regime aimed at protecting consumer rights. Having peeked at the evolution of consumer laws, particularly in India, it is crucial to address what are consumers' rights to begin with. In modern history, consumer rights have entailed, amongst others, the right to be informed about the quality, quantity, specifics, etc., of goods, services which are being availed, the right to choose from a variety of goods and services at competitive prices, right to be heard by appropriate forums, right to seek redressal against a breach of consumer rights. While the former Act of 1986 catered largely to the last part of consumer rights, that is, right to seek redressal, despite discussing each of these rights in its statements of objects and reasons, the Act of 2019, on the other hand, introduces a definition of consumer rights under Section 2, Subsection 9, which covers each of these rights and more, catering to each one of such rights within a codified, exhaustive legislation. The overall intent of creating such a paradigm shift to a codified, exhaustive legislation is reflected from the very beginning of the Act itself, from the definitions contained in the 2019 Act. We can broadly categorize these changes in the definitions under three categories. The first category are new definitions which have been introduced for the first time, such as advertisements, misleading advertisements, harm, injury, product liability, unfair contract, amongst others. The second category are existing definitions which have been modified to some extent. For instance, the definition of consumer under Section 2, Subsection 7 has been broadened under the new Act to include any person who buys and goods, whether through offline or online transactions, electronic means or teleshopping, which was not specifically provided for in the 1986 Act. In furtherance to this, detailed and comprehensive e-commerce rules have been issued on 23rd of July 2020, which impose certain duties, responsibilities, and liabilities on e-commerce entities. Similarly, the definition of unfair trade practices under Section 247 has been modified to add and specify certain unfair practices such as misleading online advertisements, disclosure of personal information, if there are non-issuance of invoices, failure to return defective goods or create and cure defective services, and refund of the amount within the prescribed time limit. The third category are definitions which have existed previously, and no substantial overhaul is brought to these terms, but they have been slightly tweaked to provide refinement and consistency in the 2019 Act. We see this from Section 2, Subsection 15, where the erstwhile District Consumer Forum has been renamed the District Commission or the District Consumer Disputes Redressal Commission in order to maintain consistency with the nomenclature of the State and National Consumer Disputes Redressal Commissions. Similarly, with the term branch office under Section 2, Subsection 3, no substantial difference is brought in the definition, but it has been reworded to provide a more refined definition of the term. I have briefly mentioned how these new definitions of advertisements and so on have been introduced in Section 2. Let us now see how these new definitions have been utilized in the 2019 Act for protecting the consumers, be it in the form of prohibition on bargain price advertisements, which are not actually bargains, withdrawal of such advertisements, or the imposition of penalties for false or misleading advertisements, which can go up to rupees 10 lakh for the first time contraventions and up to rupees 50 lakhs for subsequent contraventions. These penalties can be imposed on a manufacturer or even an endorser of a good or service. The Act therefore goes to great extents to clamp down on misleading advertisements, whether by prohibiting an endorser from endorsing a product or service for up to a year, which can extend up to 3 years for subsequent contraventions, or even going to the extent of sentence to imprisonment up to 2 years, extendable to 5 years for subsequent contraventions in the case of manufacturers. Similarly, the Act has introduced the concept of product liability, by which an obligation is cast on the manufacturer or seller to ensure safety of the product being offered, and liability is imposed for harm caused to the consumer. In fact, the 2019 Act has dedicated a full chapter, which is chapter number 6 from sections 82 to 87, to govern the duties of manufacturers and sellers of products, and sets out the liability of each in the event of harm being caused to a consumer. While the changes we have discussed may itself reflect that substantial changes have been brought about in the Act, perhaps the most significant addition to the consumer protection regime would be the addition of Chapter 3, Sections 10 to 27, that is the creation of a Central Consumer Protection Agency, or the CCPA. While the 1986 Act provided for the creation of central, state and district level consumer protection councils, which were tasked with the mandate of protecting consumer rights, which is of course retained in the 2019 Act as well, no powers of such council was specified in the 86 Act. Therefore, this lacuna is filled by the establishment of the Central Consumer Protection Agency, which has been given a defined mandate along with specified powers for the CCPA to achieve its mandate. We see from Section 10 of the CCPA that it has been formed to regulate matters relating to violation of rights of consumers, unfair trade practices, and false or misleading advertisements which are prejudicial to the interests of public and consumers, and to promote, protect, and enforce the rights of consumers. To this extent, the CCPA has been provided a dedicated investigation wing under Section 15, which is to be headed by a Director General, and even the District Collector has been roped in this process to inquire into complaints or references made by the CCPA. To aid the CCPA in achieving its mandate, Section 18, Subsection 2 empowers the CCPA to inter alia conduct an inquiry into violation of consumer rights, file complaints in this regard before the district, state or national commission, intervene in proceedings before the commissions. Further, if CCPA finds after a preliminary inquiry that a complaint or information ought to be dealt with by a regulator established under any other law, it may even refer such matter to the concerned regulator along with its report. Not only is the CCPA empowered to investigate, it is also given search and seizure powers under the CRPC for the purpose of conducting investigation under Section 22. Moreover, the CCPA may also institute complaints before the district, state and national commissions and file for intervention in matters relating to consumer rights. This shows how the Act of 2019 has drawn successful elements from the Competition Act of 2002, where also the complaints are filed through the Director General. To top all this off, the CCPA has been given real teeth by providing the power to pass orders for recall of unsafe goods or services, order reimbursement, or order discontinuation of unfair practices under Section 20, and the power to issue directions and penalties against false and misleading advertisements. Therefore, it is discernible from the establishment of the CCPA alone that a paradigm shift has taken place in the consumer protection regime from one which protected the litigious consumer to one which now preemptively protects the consumer even before they seek redressal. The new Act has transformed the consumer protection regime in India from one which was solely dependent on a post-facto adjudicatory judicial mechanism to one which has now established a nodal regulatory agency with powers to ensure protection of consumers. These powers of the CCPA do not go unchecked, and orders and directions issued by the CCPA are subject to appeal before the Honorable National Commission. It may not be out of place to mention that in the midst of the pandemic, the Ministry of Consumer Affairs on 23rd July 2020 had notified the establishment of the CCPA with effect from 24th of July as a body corporate with its headquarters at New Delhi. Now, moving to the other part, I may just here advert to the message of Justice R.K. Agarwal in 2019, where his lordship was pleased to say, and I quote, "In this era of globalization, there must be powerful consumer organizations so as to protect consumers who are not well vested with the quality of goods which they purchase or the services which are to be hired. I hope that with the establishment of the CCPA by legislative intervention, it addresses the concern as rightly flagged by Justice Agarwal and has created a statutory body itself to protect the consumers." As has already been mentioned by the Dean, Dr. Varsha Vahini, permitting e-filing of complaints and expanding territorial jurisdiction of the consumer commissions to include complainants' place of residence, akin to special jurisdiction conferred in copyright and trademark statutes, as opposed to the CPC, that is the Code of Civil Procedure route of suing only at respondent's place of business or where cause of action arises, will go a long way in increasing access to justice. One other huge hit of the 2019 Act is the introduction of reference of complaints to mediation for settlement, which not only reduces litigation, but also presents out-of-court settlement talks and which can be wrapped up within a definite and defined timelines. Such systemic changes brought about in the machinery can only be called monumental and landmark developments in the consumer rights movement. To this extent, the legislature has indeed displayed a great deal of foresight, farsight, as well as insight in tackling major issues faced in protection and promotion of consumer rights. However, without taking away from the great leaps made by the new act, I would be remiss if I failed to mention some key drawbacks with the 2019 Act presence. For starters, I must convey sincere disappointment in the pecuniary jurisdiction imposed by the 2019 Act. With the 2019 Act, it appears that the pecuniary jurisdiction of consumer commissions have been so enhanced such that complaints where the value of goods or services paid as consideration up to rupees 1 crore would lie before the district commission, between 1 crore to 10 crore before the state commission, and only when the value of goods or services paid as consideration is over 10 crores would a complaint lie before the Honorable National Commission. While I feel this may have been done with a laudable objective of ensuring that more people are able to approach the district commission, since it is easier for a common man to approach the district commission in its district, but at the same time, the execution of such a provision and actual benefit would be difficult to achieve. However, if the district commission's pecuniary jurisdiction remains on the basis of value paid as consideration for goods and services up to 1 crore, there would be little which may survive for filing in the state or national commission in their original jurisdictions. In the last 25 odd years that I have practiced before the national commission, I am still to see cases where the value paid as consideration exceeds rupees 1 crore, including home buyer complaints by individuals. Even in complaints claiming, say, rupees 50 crores against insurance companies, the premium paid as consideration often is only a figure in a few lakhs at most. The result of this would be that a complaint against an insurance company for a relief of, say, rupees 50 crores, wherein premium of 15 lakhs have been paid, which requires considerable time, attention, and expertise to hear and decide, would be put at par with a complaint of a common man who is, say, seeking refund of rupees 8,000 for a faulty phone he may have purchased. In such a scenario, one cannot help but apprehend that the common person's smaller claim may be put on the back burner when competing and jostling for space in the district commission calendar pitted against a 50 crore claim, both filed before the district commission. The district commissions, which are already overburdened, will face a docket explosion with cases which would ordinarily have lied before the state and national commissions. If you see the district, state and national commission as a pyramid of the grievance redressal mechanism, the bottom tier of the district commission will end up bearing the entire weight of the pyramid, and this overburdening may lead to the entire pyramid itself collapsing. One possible solution to this problem may be by increasing the number of district commissions in each district, which would not only assist in the distribution of docket loads, but would also aid accessibility to district commissions itself. Indeed, there would be but a handful of cases where consideration paid towards a good or service would exceed rupees 1 crore. If I am permitted by the Honorable Chair, I would like to say that approaching the National Commission in original jurisdiction would result in a situation where the common phrase consumer is king will turn into only king can be consumer. This would also result in the State Commission and National Commission being rendered as only appellate courts rather than courts of original jurisdiction, causing a suboptimal utilization of the valuable resources, being the expertise and wisdom of the members of the state and Honorable Commission. We may also note another missed opportunity in the 2019 Act, which pertains to strict timelines. While the recent judgment of the Constitution Bench of the Supreme Court in Hilly Multipurpose, which reiterates the position as taken by the Supreme Court in J.J. Merchant's case, has emphasized on and aided the speedy disposal of justice by providing a mandatory timeline of 30 plus 15 days within which a written version is to be filed in response to a complaint, this judicial intervention has reduced dilatory tactics which can be employed. The 2019 Act has missed a valuable opportunity to introduce strict timelines within which other filings, such as documents, evidence by way of affidavits, written submissions, etc., could have been filed by the parties. The Act ought to have embodied the spirit behind the Hilly Multipurpose judgment and provided that a failure to file documents or evidence or written submission in time would lead to the right to file such documents or written submissions being closed. In the last several years, I have seen months and years go by and parties still seek last opportunity in perpetuity to file evidence or written submissions. Such gross and inordinate delay at the hands of respondents and complainants alike result in gross delay in disposal of matters and waste of judicial time. At the same time, I must say that another discrepancy, which is of course a minor discrepancy, but I could not find the rationale behind it, is that the appeal period from district commission to state commission has been kept at 45 days, whereas the appeal provision from state commission to national commission has been kept at 30 days. And I could not find any reasonable basis for such a distinction being made. So what we see today is that the 2019 Act undoubtedly has made leaps and bounds in the context of its predecessor Act and has attempted to take numerous challenges head on and introduce a comprehensive and robust code to replace existing consumer protection regime. This Act appears to be largely well-intentioned and well thought of. I came across one reportage of the 2019 Act in a newspaper headline, and I quote, "Justice for all, new angel, not much better than old devil," unquote. While this may be an oversimplification, and indeed, the 2019 Act has brought about monumental changes in the consumer protection regime, which elevates the Indian consumer protection movement to the next level. However, certain aspects of the Act either leave some room for doubt or leave certain issues unaddressed. I also sincerely hope that former US President John F. Kennedy's concerns about consumer protection in his address to the US Congress on 15th of March 1962 to find a suitable resolution in the 2019 Act, and I quote the former president, "Consumers by definition include us all. They are the largest economic group affecting and affected by almost every public and private economic decisions. Yet they are the only economic group whose views are often not heard, unquote. The 2019 Act, while largely a hit and achieving a great deal of good, may hopefully be effectively implemented and effectuated in the overall architecture of protecting the consumer. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Basu. It was really heartening to hear the way you try to bring about a balance of how the new Act has achieved, where all it has reached, and where all it has missed. I was really impressed by the term which you used, that the king may be the consumer. So we all hope that, of course, the new Act is well-intentioned, and the key lies in the implementation. But can we traverse the path where we say that the king is the consumer, or the consumer may be the king? So thank you so much, Mr. Basu. It was really a pleasure listening from you about the Consumer Protection Act 2019. And now I would like to invite Honorable Justice R.K. Agarwal on this event. But before he starts speaking for all the audience, let me just give you a little brief about who Justice R.K. Agarwal is. He retired from the Supreme Court on May 4th, 2018, and he was appointed as a president of the NCDRC on July 1st, 2018. He served as the Chief Justice of Madras High Court from 24th October 2013 till his elevation to the Supreme Court. He started practicing law in 1976, having joined the chambers of his father, Raja Ram Agarwal, a senior advocate and former Advocate General of the State of Uttar Pradesh. He was elevated as a permanent judge of the Allahabad High Court on 5th of February 1999, where he served until his transfer to the Madras High Court as the acting Chief Justice on February 6, 2013. So I welcome Justice R.K. Agarwal, and over to you, sir.
Dear friends, a very good evening to all of you. I deem it a matter of pride, pleasure, and privilege to be with you, and I extend my sincere appreciation to the Faculty of Law, Manu Rasna University, Suvika online platform, and Bar and Bench, the media partner, for organizing this webinar on the issue of hits and misses of the Consumer Protection Act 2019, which has come into force with effect from 24th of July 2020. A consumer is defined as someone who acquires goods or services for direct use or ownership, rather than for resale or use in production and manufacturing. In our day-to-day life, we become consumers through buying goods or services. With the advent of digital technologies, increasing influence of e-commerce, smartphones, cloud and internet, and global supply chains have provided new opportunities for consumers by providing easy access of products and services. But on the other hand, today's consumer is vulnerable to new forms of challenges, such as online fraud, ATM data leak, getting defective, substandard, duplicate, poor quality, and unsafe products, predatory prices, exploitative and unfair trade, and unethical business practices. Further, misleading advertisements, especially digital telemarketing, multi-level marketing, direct selling, and e-tailing are some other challenges which never existed in 1986 when the Consumer Protection Act 1986 was framed. Following the guidelines of the United Nations, our Parliament enacted Consumer Protection Act in the year 1986 to provide a mechanism for cheaper and speedy redressal of the grievances of the consumers. The 1986 Act sought to promote and protect the rights of the consumers against marketing of goods, availing of services which are hazardous to life and property. It also provided for right to be informed about the quality, quantity, potency, purity, standard, prices of the goods, and unfair trade practices of the manufacturers and service providers. The basic objective of enacting the 1986 Act was to balance the power equation between the poor consumers and the powerful business merchants. But the digital age has ushered in a new era of commerce and digital branding, as well as a new set of customer expectations. Digitization has provided easy access, a large variety of choice, convenient payment mechanism, improved services, and shopping as per convenience. However, along with the growth path, it also brought in new challenges related to consumer protection, as the consumers are still victims of unscrupulous and exploitative practices. Exploitation of consumers assumes numerous forms, such as adulteration of food, spurious drugs, high prices, poor quality, deficient services, deceptive advertisements, hazardous products, and many more due to globalization and international trade, which has offered new goods in the field of insurance, transport, electricity, housing, entertainment, finance, banking, e-commerce, etc. The 1986 Act was brought in with the intention to protect consumers' interest and bring shift from the then prevalent concept of caveat emptor, let the buyers beware, to caveat venditor, sellers be aware. The 1986 Act regulated the consumer market for both goods and services and issues arising thereunder for a long period of more than 30 years, with three amendments in the year 1991, 1993, and 2002. But the potential of the internet to create a virtual borderless market made the domestic territorial-based consumer protection laws incompatible with the non-territorial or cross-border nature of e-transactions, raising issues relating to enforceabilities of judgments and laws. To protect the rights of all users in the digital world, increased attention was required from a regulatory, legislative, as well as adjudicative perspective. While the 1986 Act had survived long, but a mere survival had raised various questions on the fulfillment of its objective and dire need of an amendment or a replacement to fulfill the dynamic needs of the customers. This apart, there are a plethora of cases pending before the consumer forums, and because of considerable delay in disposal of cases by the redressal agencies, despite a disposal rate of about 90% of the complaints, the 1986 Act failed to meet the expectations of the consumers and to achieve the objectives for which it was enacted. A speedy disposal of cases is an important issue for all concerned, as delay in justice is denial of justice. Hence, it was become inevitable to amend the Act to address the myriad and constantly emerging vulnerabilities of the consumers. The government, instead of bringing another amendment to the Act of 1986, enacted a new Act altogether, that is the present Consumer Protection Act 2019. The objective to introduce a novel Act was primarily to provide enhanced protection to the consumers while keeping the track record in the account and the exponential boom in the e-commerce industry, including all the modern methods used for providing goods and services to the consumers via online mode. The rubrics of the Act has been designed in a way to provide safety of the pursuit of consumers, a mechanism to settle shoppers' dispute, the establishment of central grievance resolving authority, and regulation on deceptive advertisements. The developments of the new Act attempt to cover effective administration and well-timed disposal of consumer grievances and complaints. The preamble of the new Act is, I quote, an Act to provide for protection of the interests of consumers and for the said purpose to establish authorities for timely and effective administration and settlement of consumers' disputes and for matters connected thereto or incidental thereto. The 2019 Act has widened the reach of the consumer protection regime in our country. The changes made by the 2019 Act seem to further empower consumers by leveraging responsibilities not only on their counterparts, that is the sellers, manufacturers, service providers, but also the endorsers of such products. It also attempts to address the issues that were not comprehensively touched upon in the 1986 Act, such interests of consumers as a class, etc. It also aims to ease and fasten the process of consumer disputes resolution by increasing the pecuniary jurisdiction of the consumer fora, attaching mediation cells, granting permission to use electronic media, imposing higher penalties, etc. Some of the highlights of the 2019 Act are, while the 1986 Act was facing various difficulties with its implementation on various teleshopping and online transactions, the 2019 Act has removed any model on its applicability in similar circumstances. The definition of the term consumer under subsection 7 of section 2 has been expanded to include an explanation for the term buys and goods and hires or avails any service. The explanation clarifies that the said term includes offline as well as online transactions made through electronic means. Therefore, the 2019 Act specifically includes e-commerce transactions in its ambit. For the first time, the 2019 Act has also attempted to define e-commerce. subsection 16 of section 2 of the 2019 act contemplates that e-commerce means buying or selling of goods or services including digital products over digital electronic network. Further, subsection 17 of section 2 provides that electronic service provider means a person who provides technologies or processes to enable a product seller to engage in advertising or selling goods or services to a consumer, and includes any online marketplace or online auction sites. The term deficiency has also been redefined in the 2019 Act. Subsection 11 of Section 2 of the 2019 Act defines the word deficiency as any act of negligence or omission or commission by such person which causes loss or injury to the consumer, and deliberate withholding of relevant information by such person to the consumer. The 1986 Act indeed had failed to provide a regulator to enforce the consumer rights. Keeping this in mind, a provision has been made under Section 10 of the 2019 Act for establishment of a national level regulator called the Central Consumer Protection Authority, which will be headed by the Chief Commissioner and comprise other commissioners. The authority will have an investigation arm headed by the Director General for the purpose of conducting inquiry or investigation under the Act. It has to deal with rights of consumer as a class. It has also the power of search and seizure in the matters which are prejudicial to the interest of the public and the consumers. The authority is also vested with so much of power to inquire into any violation.
There appears to be a technical glitch. I think Justice Agarwal's video link has discontinued. We'll just wait for His Lordship to join back.
Yes, yes. In fact, it's really been heartening to hear Justice R.K. Agarwal also. There have been a lot of questions coming in. And in fact, I was wanting to pitch in with a question. One of the attendees have put out a question. In fact, I think the timing of this webinar couldn't have been better when 15th of March is observed as the Consumer Rights Day. Just waiting for Justice Agarwal to get connected. Shashank, you would say something?
I think Justice Agarwal has joined back. I can see his name screen. We'll just wait for his video to start.
I'm sorry for the interruption because of some technical glitch. I'm very sorry. A new concept of product loyalty has been introduced in Chapter 6 by the 2019 Act, which was in dire need of section, dire need of. Subsection 34 of Section 2 defines the term product liability. Sections 82 to 87 of the new Act deal with the procedure of product liability. The 2019 Act a complainant to make a claim of product service provider or even a product seller for any personal injury, illness, death or property damage resulting from defects in manufacture, construction, design, formula preparation, assembly testing, service, warning, instructions, marking, packing, labeling of any product, etc. The 2019 Act has gone a step forward and defined a product manufacturer, product seller and product service provider to provide clarity on who can be made liable for an action. Insertion of product liability as a separate chapter in the 2019 Act and a new ground for filing a complaint has been one of the most significant additions of this Act. The definition of the product liability has very effectively brought online market within the ambit of Consumer Protection Act. Online retail platforms can be made liable for the products available for sale on their websites. In the previous legislation, a complaint could be filed only if an unfair trade practice or a restrictive trade practice was adopted by any trader or service provider. Now, unfair contract has also been added, which further broadens the ground to file complaints and allows consumers to challenge contracts which are unfair, unilateral, and unreasonable. Subsection 46 of Section 2 of the new Act defines the term unfair contract. This provision essentially bars execution of any such contract which ex facie favors the manufacturers or the service providers and is against the interests of the consumers. To meet the objective of providing speedy, inexpensive justice, especially to small consumers, as observed by the Supreme Court in a catena of judgments, a new Chapter 5 on mediation as an alternative dispute resolution mechanism has been inserted in the 2019 Act. The new Act contemplates that the attachment to the consumer fora of a mediation cell and reference thereto of any complaint upon its admission if it appears to the concerned district, state or national commission that there exists elements of a possible settlement between the disputing parties in the complaint. Subsection 25 of Section 2 of the Act defines the mediation. Section 37 deals with the reference of a consumer dispute to the mediation. Similarly, Section 74, 75, and 80 deal with establishment and composition of consumer mediation cell, procedure for empanelment of mediators in the mediation cell, and settlement through mediation. Further, Section 81 of the 2019 Act prescribes the procedure to pass suitable order for recording such settlement. Subsection 28 of Section 2 defines misleading advertisement quite widely. It includes advertisement relating to any product or service that falsely describes such product or service or gives false guarantee about the same and thereby misleading the consumers about such products or service nature, substance, quality, or quantity. It also includes advertisements that convey an express or implied representation made by the manufacturer or seller or service provider, thereby constituting to be unfair trade practice. It also includes advertisements which deliberately conceal important functions of such product or services. The authority may impose a penalty up to ₹10 lakhs on a manufacturer or an endorser for a false or misleading advertisement. The authority may also sentence them to imprisonment for up to 2 years for the same. In a case of subsequent offense, the fine may extend to ₹50 lakhs and imprisonment up to 5 years. The authority can also prohibit the endorser of a misleading advertisement from endorsing that particular product or service for a period up to 1 year. For every subsequent offense, the period of prohibition may extend to 3 years. Now, this amendment brought in the new Act puts caution on the endorsers that they should be very careful in endorsing any product. If it is found misleading or the information given in the advertisement is not correct, the endorser himself may be made liable for penalty or prosecution, whatever the case may be. Several other provisions have been made in the 2019 Act to simplify the consumer dispute resolution process. Under the 1986 Act, the pecuniary jurisdiction was ascertained on the basis of value of goods or services and the compensation, if any, claimed. The 2019 Act decides the jurisdiction on value of goods or services paid as consideration. Thus, the old practice of forum shopping by inflating the compensation claim has been done away with, and the pecuniary jurisdiction shall now be fixed based on the consideration actually paid by the consumer. Further, the upper limit of pecuniary jurisdiction of the district forum, state commission, and the national commission has been increased from the existing ₹20 lakhs, 1 crore, and above ₹1 crore to ₹1 crore, ₹10 crore, and 10 crore and above, respectively. Recently, the National Commission, the case of Pyari Lal Chabiraj Steels Private Limited versus National Insurance Company, complaint case number 833 of 2020, decided on 28th of August 2020, has held that where the complainant had obtained the insurance policies of about ₹41 crores and odd by paying only a premium of ₹4 lakhs and odd, the complaint was not maintainable before the National Commission for want of pecuniary jurisdiction. But as my friend Mr. Joy Basu, the learned counsel, stated that this will make all the consumers to first approach the state district commission, because the consideration paid it would be not more than 1 crore. In exceptional cases, it may exceed. I may only say that under Section 34, 47, and 58 of the Consumer Protection Act 2019, a proviso has been added empowering the central government to reduce or modify the pecuniary jurisdiction on the figures or the data which may be made available to it. And if it is found that the consumer complaints are filed in large numbers before the district state commission, and there are few complaints being filed in the state commission, the national commission, the central government may consider revising the limit of the pecuniary jurisdiction of the district forum, the state commission, and the national commission. So there is nothing to fear about it. It has to be implemented for about a year. The figures will come, and then the central government may take action, appropriate steps. So far as the observation made by my esteemed lawyer, Mr. Joy Basu, that the king would be consumer is not correct. For in our democratic setup, everybody is treated equal. there cannot be a king, there cannot be a slave or a downtrodden. So everybody has to approach one forum. There cannot be any differentiation. If a big multinational files a consumer complaint before the district forum, then it should be treated at par with the one filed by a poor man or a person below poverty line. There cannot be any priority given to any complaint filed by a multinational company or a big consumer or a small consumer. Now, under section 40, 50, and 60 of the 2019 Act, the district consumer forum, the state commission, the national commission, respectively, have the powers to review any of its order if there is an error on the face of the record, either of its own motion or an application made by any of the parties within 30 days of the date of the order. The date of the order here would not mean the date when the order has been passed, but when the order has been received by the aggrieved person. Further, the district commission and the state commission have not been given power to recall ex parte orders because it will not come within the power of review. But in case on the material available on record, it is established that the order directing to proceed ex parte was passed on a wrong mention being made in the record that the notice has been served, whereas it has not been specifically served, then it will come under the power of review. Under section 30, clause D of subsection 2 of section 34 of the 2019 Act included the place of residence of the complainant and place where the complainant personally works for gain for determining the territorial jurisdiction of the commission, thereby making it a wider and easier approach. Provision of establishment of regional benches of the state commission as well as the national commission has been made in the new Act to deliver the justice at the door of the poor consumers. But this power of establishing regional benches have to be exercised by the state government in the case of state commissions and the central government in the case of national commission. The president of the state commissions or the president of the national commission, suo motu, cannot establish any regional bench. A complaint can now be filed electronically under section 36 of the new Act, and if the issue of admissibility of the complaint is not decided within periods so specified, it shall be deemed to have been admitted. The 2019 Act provides relief to the aggrieved party in terms of the period for preferring an appeal. Instead of 30 days, now an appeal can be preferred against the order passed by the district commissioner within 45 days to the state commission. Whereas the pre-deposit amount for preferring an appeal has been increased from ₹25,000 to 50% of the amount ordered by the district forum. However, the National Commission, in the case of Messrs. Sahyog Homes Limited and others versus Manoj Shah, diary number 13929-13932 of 2020 and connected matters, decided on 12th of October 2020, has held that the complaint has been filed before the implementation of the 2019 Act, that is, before 20th or 24th of July 2020, the amount of precondition to entertainment, the deposit of amount as a precondition to entertaining the appeal has to be in terms of the Consumer Protection Act 1986, because our vested right to file an appeal accrues to the person the moment the complaint is filed before the district commission or the state commission, as the case may be. The 2019 Act has also sought to increase the culpability of the offenses that may be committed against the consumers and have made the penal provisions more severe and deterrent for non-compliance of the interim orders. It has attempted to bring Consumer Protection Act under the ambit of criminal jurisprudence. Section 71 of the 2019 Act states that every order made by the district commission, state commission, or the national commission shall be enforced by it in the same manner as if it was a decree made by a court in a suit before it, and the provisions of Order 21 of the first schedule to the Code of Civil Procedure 1908 shall, as far as may be applicable, subject to the modification that every reference therein to the decree shall be construed as reference to the orders made under this Act. Subsection 1 of Section 72 further provides that whosoever fails to comply with any order made by the District Commission or the State Commission or the National Commission, as the case may be, shall be punishable with imprisonment for a term which shall not be less than 1 month, but which may extend to 3 years, or with fine, which shall not be less than 25,000 rupees, but which may extend to to 1 lakh rupees or with both. However, a right of appeal has been given under subsection 73, subsection 3 of the Consumer Protection Act 2019 to the next higher forum. But only one right of appeal has been provided. There is no further right of appeal or revision provided against an order passed under subsection 1 of section 72 of the Act, as already held by the Honorable Supreme Court in the case of Karnataka Housing Board. No revision lies against an order passed in proceedings in execution where the order has been passed exercising criminal jurisdiction, because complaint is not pending. A right of revision is applicable only when the complaint is pending. This was observed, this was held under the provision of the 1986 Act, but the same provision is still there and no amendment has been made. So if an order has been passed in appeal under subsection 3 of section 72 of the Act, then the only remedy which may be available to an aggrieved person is either to approach the Honorable High Court under Article 227 of the Constitution of India, or to approach the Honorable Supreme Court by filing a petition for judicial leave under Article 136 of the Constitution of India. In nutshell, the 2019 Act has focused on enforcing the consumer rights along with timely and effective administration of consumer disputes. Certainly, the new Act is more in tune with modern day concepts of consumer protection, new market dynamics, and developments in the digital age. It deals with unfair contracts and e-commerce issues. It provides for e-filing of complaints and product liability suits. It also provides for mediation in addition to the earlier system of consumer justice, and empowers the Central Consumer Protection Authority or the regulator to recall unsafe goods or services, order reimbursement of their price, put a stop to unfair trade practice, including false and misleading advertisements, order investigations into violation of consumer rights, and in general, promote, protect, and enforce the rights of consumers as a class. But still, there are certain issues for concern, which are: the 2019 Act in its current form does not explicitly specify healthcare in the list of services listed in the definition of service, even though in the Consumer Protection Bill 2018, which was passed by the Lok Sabha, it was included in. A question may arise as to whether the 2019 Act is still applicable to the healthcare services or not, as it has not been specifically been excluded from the Act. The principles laid down by the Honorable Supreme Court in the case of Indian Medical Association versus V.P. Samta, 1995 Supreme Court Cases, Volume 6, page 651, may still be applicable. There can be a possibility of clash with regard to scope of Central Consumer Protection Authority and the prevailing consumer fora in cases of certain class of consumers or subject matters which may be taken up by both the bodies. As such, there must have been a prescribed hierarchy or creation of a separate class in order to avoid such conflict. Section 99 of the new Act directs the Central Consumer Protection Authority to act in terms of the direction issued by the central government, which may restrict its autonomy. On introduction of the concept of product liability, there may be frivolous claims solely on the basis of discrepancy in designs, even when it results in no actual damage to the consumer or is done in order to improve functionality. There is no provision in the new Act imposing penalty for unsafe products and services which lead to a large-scale deaths and injuries in the country. Under the new Act, the pecuniary jurisdiction has to be determined on the basis of consideration actually paid. Such a reading of this provision may particularly impact flat purchasers, where even though the value of the property may be above rupees 1 crore, but because they have paid a lesser consideration, they would be denied the right to approach the state or national commission, as the case may be. The Consumer Protection Mediation Rules 2020. I would like to conclude with the words that the changes that have been made in the 2019 safer fairer market for the consumers to interact.
The last 2 minutes, there was a disconnection. Just yes. When you started your conclusion.
Very well. Just a minute. Yeah. The 2019 Act has focused on enforcing the consumer rights along with timely and effective administration of consumer disputes. Certainly, the new Act is more in tune with modern day concepts of consumer protection, new market dynamics, and developments in the digital age. It deals with unfair contracts and e-commerce issues. It provides for e-filing of complaints and product liability suits. It also provides for mediation in addition to the earlier system of consumer justice and empower the Central Consumer Protection Authority or the regulator to recall unsafe goods or services, order reimbursement of their price, put a stop to unfair trade practice, including false and misleading advertisements, order investigations into violation of consumer rights, and in general promote, protect, and enforce the rights of consumers as a class. But still there are certain issues for concern, which are the question of healthcare services, whether it stands excluded or not under the new Act, then the possibility of clash of the jurisdiction in respect of consumer complaints with the Consumer Protection Authority as also the consumer forums, because no guidelines have been laid down. The autonomy of the Consumer Protection Authority may be undermined by the directions issued by the central government, which has to be followed. And frivolous claims can also be filed. फिर बंद हो गया, ये कैसे हो रहा है, क्या हो रहा है यहाँ पे?
Sir, you are connected. We can hear you, sir.
Yes. So that are my some of the views. I may be right, I may be wrong. I can't say that I am always right. Right? So it is for you people to judge as to whether I was right or not.
Thank you very much, sir. Indeed, great privilege and honor to have heard Honorable Justice Agarwal and Mr. Joy Basu on such detailed insights of the Consumer Protection Act 2019. We were fortunate to receive some advanced questions from students as well as practitioners. I do not think that most of these questions would have would hold any value, since everything has been answered in the detailed address of Honorable Justice Agarwal and Mr. Joy Basu, especially focusing on the misses which Mr. Basu indicated with respect to the pecuniary jurisdiction, and Justice Agarwal, when he mentioned about contemporary powers with the CCPA and the consumer forums. But I'll still make an endeavor to put some of the questions that have been asked to us on the Q&A window and some of the advanced questions which may still make some sense. The first question is for both the panelists. So why do you think Consumer Protection 2019 Act is considered a milestone, as there has already been so many amendments to the existing 1986 Act? Meaning thereby, in other words, why do you think there was a need to replace the 1986 Act altogether instead of doing an overhaul by bringing further amendments?
Yes. Should I first, or my friend Basu, Mr. Basu will first answer?
My lord, I will follow your lordship, my lord. So,
you see, the question of giving a new Act of 2019 serves many purpose. In the 1986 Act, there were three amendments made in the year 1991, 1993, and 2002, right? But if you see, making amendments in the Act, of course, makes you can improve or remove the deficiencies which you may find in the working of an enactment. But making lot of amendments will make it, as a result, I would say, you don't take it otherwise, it is on the lighter side. It will become an Income Tax Act of 1961, in which one section of an act has many subsections, and those subsections have many sub clauses. So it is very difficult to reconcile all the provisions. So if a new enactment has been given effect to, in my considered view, it is a good thing that the old enactment has been repealed, a new act has come into force. Whatever deficiency has been faced in the old act has been given a removed, so that let us see how it works. There may still all deficiencies cannot be removed by enacting an act. It always remains. Take the case of our Constitution of India. There had been 102 amendments, if I'm not mistaken. That doesn't mean that the Constitution of India should be replaced. It is another thing. But for a certain enactment, if you find so many deficiencies, an amendment may bring many subsections, subclauses, explanations, provisos, then it is better to have a new act so that there may be a one go. You can interpret in one go.
I totally endorse what has fallen from my Lord Justice Agarwal. And if I can just add just a couple of points to that. One is that the Consumer Protection Act has to be viewed differently from other legislations, because many a time it is a consumer who himself will have a look at the act. So it has to be, as rightly pointed out by my Lord, it has to be very lucid. It has to be very, very easy, right? It is not to be seen through the eyes of a lawyer in the stricto sense of the term, right? So therefore, if something is to be made lucid, something is to be made simple, then several amendments over and over a period of time becomes extremely difficult for the common man to make it an intelligible piece of legislation for him to redress those grievances. That's one. Secondly, is that more than 30 years have passed, and we are in the digital age, as Justice Agarwal also during his address emphasized on several occasions, right? So therefore, in essence, the foundation on which the 1986 Act was built has actually been displaced to a great extent. Today, though it may be phonetically similar, consumerism sounds similar to commercialism, but the two are poles apart. So today, when I look at the television screen and I'm trying to catch my attention on a line of sight where Virat Kohli is playing his cover drive or straight drive, my eyesight has to navigate from one corner of the screen where some shoe manufacturer's advertisement is coming. So the bottom screen is taken about some ticker is going through. The top of the screen, quarter of it is already covered. And therefore, in the age of commercialism, right, consumer movement and the rights of the consumer to have its pride of place required a new enactment. That is why, say, the so-called advertising, so much of emphasis has been laid in the new act, which my Lord Justice Agarwal was emphasizing upon, on advertising, on misleading advertising, on the endorser being hauled up today, right? The reason is commercialism. So in order to have and to protect the consumer from this wave of commercialism which has come in, you needed a completely new platform, you needed a completely new foundation, you needed a completely new edifice, right, to take on commercialism. So that's also, I feel, that one of the reasons could be to have a change which is akin to the Arbitration Act of 1940. You needed a wholesale change in 1996 to come out with a new act, because the amendments would not survive the purpose, right? So probably that was the reason, and rightly they have done a great job, and they rose to the occasion and made a new legislation.
Just a follow-up of what you just said, Mr. Basu, with respect to the act being used for the consumer to read it and interpret it, and in many cases, consumer likes to file their litigation themselves and fight it also themselves. Do you think the act should have also envisaged adding legal aid to consumer rules?
Yes, but at the same time, subject to correction by my Lord Justice Agarwal, if it is not specifically mentioned in the act, but there have been instances on several occasions which I have witnessed wherein if any counsels are required to be engaged by somebody who either does not have the requisite resources or who is not conversant with the procedure, the National Commission, at least I have seen it for myself, the benches have come forward and have appointed counsels on behalf of such consumers to prosecute such cases. So therefore, in essence, if it is not part of the statute, but it actually is an active practice.
The National Commission, sir.
I may clarify, so far as the legal aid is concerned, we are very liberal in providing legal aid if there is a request by the consumer. And we consider to provide the best legal aid without any charges. We have to pay, reimburse the counsel. So, and even though mediation was not there in 1986 Act, but I may bring to the information of all participants that I had been adopting this technique of mediation by calling the clients, litigants, not the lawyers, in my chambers and just asking them, what is your problem of the consumer? And then the opposite party, you have heard, what is your reply? So please, and in 90% of such cases, matter has been solved and people have gone happy. Now mediation has come in the act itself, statutory recognition, and the order passed by mediator will be final. It can't be appealed.
So just on the lighter side, I wanted to add that National Commission has the advantage of having competent lawyers like Mr. Basu being there, but the same advantage may not be there with district forums and state commissions. So I think if there are clearer rules on legal aid to consumers and there is education of consumer in that regard, that may also be of great benefit to the consumers. Because many times they are against these multinational corporations who get best of legal representation, even at the stages of district forum and state commissions. Moving forward, I wanted to ask Honorable Justice Agarwal, so Act gives some more power to CCPA, but is there something which needs to be done with respect to forums? Should forums also get some more power?
In my considered opinion, the forum being the creature of the statute should not be given any suo motu powers. Otherwise, it will become just like suo motu courts taking suo motu PIL. That will become the order of the day. In the district commission, in the state commission, and the national commission, it will be very difficult to coordinate, right? And if an authority has already been empowered to take suo motu action, that serves the interest of the consumers.
Therefore, it may be possible for the forums to, even if they come across some product liability issue, to refer it to the concerned authority.
Yes, sir.
Mr. Basu, a point that you mentioned regarding endorsement, Justice Agarwal had captured it in his address also. It is one of the major amendments that have been brought in the 2019 Act. I wanted to understand, how does it safeguard the manufacturer? I mean, of course, it safeguards the consumer. What is the threshold of evidence? Because one consumer may say that I saw an advertisement, so-and-so's star was endorsing, and I bought this product, but it has not worked on my skin. I want to now sue that endorser, that celebrity, for violation of the Act. What is the threshold that we are talking about? Are we considering that our consumer is an educated consumer, or it can, I mean, there is absolutely, no evidence is required, just mere complaint and proper purchase is shown, would that be sufficient? Is that something that has already been addressed in any of the judgments?
Well, India, the people of India are very passionate. So whether it is cricket, whether it is movies, whether it is cricketers, whether it is film stars. So there is a blind faith and a blind following, which, of course, without taking any names and without taking any names of any products and so on. But in the past, it has been found that just for commercial gain, there had been endorsements made without making any background check on the quality, content, and details of what is being endorsed. So the commercial value as being paid to the endorser was the denominator. Now that led to a lot of, if I may say, I should not use the term unlawful, but endorsements which should have been made after a due diligence had been made by the endorser. Now that practice has been flagged here in the new dispensation of the Consumer Protection Act of 2019. And it not only makes the manufacturer liable, but also the endorser, which if you now see, even if you see some newspaper reports and so on and so forth, or the current affairs, even movie stars or cricket stars now make a due diligence and background check on the product. And unless and until they are satisfied about the credentials of that product, about what the product stands for, they will not endorse it anymore. So that's the welcome change which has come about. That's point number one. Secondly, about the safety mechanism, there is a provision in the Act itself, I can't recall it right away, which protects the endorser if he has done the due diligence. And if he has, and if he can show to the court that he had done the requisite due diligence, he had made the requisite inquiries, whatever reasonably possible on his part to find about that product from the manufacturers or the suppliers and so on and so forth. And if he can show these factual aspects to a court of law, then he will be exonerated from any liability. So therefore, it's a very balanced position that the Act takes. So on the one hand, an arbitrary endorsement, right? It puts a check on that. And on the second, if somebody, if an endorser is kind of goaded down the garden path, wherein in spite of taking and making all efforts to know about the product, right, he is given, in fact, or fed wrong information, then the endorser is exonerated from any liability. So there's a fine balance which is struck in the Act itself.
May I add one thing?
Sir.
Section 5 of Section 21 of the new Act makes the endorser not liable if he has proved that he has exercised due diligence to verify the veracity of the claims made in the advertisement regarding the product or service being endorsed by him. So subsection 5 specifically exonerates the endorser. If he proves that he has made due diligence, he will not be liable. But I would like to add one more thing here. If you go in the past, if you can kindly recollect, there was one cream sold by a leading multinational of this country, right? And the, I would say, now I may name the cream also, Fair and Lovely. And it was found that the name which they are claiming, it will, if you use it, you will become fair and lovely, was not correct, was not up to the mark. They had to change the name. Some penalty was imposed by the advertising authority, not because it couldn't come under the Consumer Protection Act at that time. And the endorser was not even called for any punishment, etc. But with the new enactment of the misleading advertisement, endorsers are also liable. So this type of practice will have a, you will say, check on it.
My question was, in fact, Lordship gave example of Fair and Lovely. I was thinking of example of Red Bull. The advertisement said it gives you wings. So what happens when somebody drinks a Red Bull and he is unable to fly? What? So in that respect.
Right. But Mr. Agar, you see, wings has many meanings. Supposing after drinking, you feel flying, what thing remains there?
So that was on the lighter side. I have received a query on the chat from Ms. Divya Jyoti Jaipuria, who is the president of District Consumer Commission 7 Southwest Delhi. Her question is that new legislation has done away with the provision for penalizing complaints for filing frivolous complaints. How can Consumer Commission now deal with such vexatious and frivolous complaints?
Yes, even though it has done away with, but the District Commission, the State Commission, the National Commission has the power to impose cost, right? If the Commission comes to the conclusion that frivolous complaints have been filed, misleading complaints have been filed, or unintentional, or just to harass a person, the complaint has been filed, then by dismissing the complaint at the threshold, it can impose cost, and that cost can be heavy also.
There is one more question from Mr. Divyanshu Gupta. He is asking, considering the RERA Act came after the old Consumer Protection Act, the RERA Act was treated to be in a way superior to the old CPA as it came afterwards, both being special acts. Why the Pioneer judgment emphasized that complainants filing their petitions before RERA would have to withdraw their complaints before the consumer fora in terms of the first proviso of Section 71(1) of RERA Act. However, since the new CPA Act has come in after RERA, would the Pioneer judgment and the proviso of 71(1) still hold good, or would the new CPA 2019 Act would hold good over RERA Act?
You see, if the consumer has withdrawn the complaint under subsection 71 of section 71 under the RERA Act, then it was okay. But if under the 2019 Act, there is no such provision, there is no question of withdrawing it for filing it. Of course, it is for the commission to give liberty to file. That is another thing. And as the Honorable Supreme Court in Pioneer Urban case and also in Imperia constructions or whatever it is, recently it has been held that a person has a right, freedom to oppose RERA authorities, the consumer forums, as also the NCLT, because all the three enactments like RERA Act, Consumer Protection Act, and the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code, they are separate. They give separate powers. They don't debar or prohibit the others from approaching any forum. It is the choice of the person which forum has to be approached. It cannot come as a bar. And therefore, if a consumer complaint is filed now, even though RERA is there, IBC is there, of course, in IBC now 10% purchasers of real estate have to be there, but still, if 10% are there, they can oppose the NCLT, or they may file a joint complaint in the consumer forums. It cannot be a bar.
If I can just add to that, my Lord, absolutely what is falling from my Lord Justice Agarwal, that is what the Honorable Supreme Court has laid down, and Justice Nariman in the Pioneer judgment especially talks about coordinate jurisdictions.
Right.
That's and it absolutely does not bar if I can put it, the doctrine of election, which is to be exercised by the consumer. So it is a coordinate jurisdiction, and therefore there's no question of one law superseding the other as the question appears to be. And my Lord Justice Agarwal has correctly and absolutely interpreted the Pioneer judgment and the Imperia judgment, that it does not bar the invocation and election by the consumer, whether of the IBC or of the RERA or of the Consumer Protection Act, and they are coordinate jurisdictions.
Thank you. Mr. Basu, you had already mentioned this, but there is a question by a gentleman asking, how will the pecuniary jurisdiction determine in insurance cases whether it would be on the basis of the premium that has been originally paid or on the claim amount?
That has already been interpreted by my Lord Justice Agarwal's judgment in one of the recent cases. And rightly so, and the provision of the Consumer Protection Act has been rightly interpreted there. Paid, the words used are paid as consideration. Now, paid as consideration under the new dispensation means the premium which is paid. So, irrespective of the relief which is claimed, the premium amount which is paid will determine the jurisdiction. So, therefore, if the premium paid is less than 1 crore, then irrespective of the final relief being claimed, which may be more than 100 crores also, the matter has to go to the district commission now, to the exclusion of either the state commission or the national commission. That's where what the law as is of now today.
To Honorable Justice Agarwal, sir, with the introduction of e-filing of complaints and with the enhancement of jurisdiction of consumer forums at each level, do you think there would be a sudden change or a quantum leap in the amount of cases that will get registered in the coming years? And do you think the infrastructure is equipped to handle that?
with the increase of the pecuniary jurisdiction of the district commission to 1 crore and the state commission from 1 crore to 10 crores, there will be filing of consumer complaints on the original site before the district commission will increase manifold. Even in the state commission, it may increase because some of the complaints which were being filed before the national commission, now they don't have the pecuniary jurisdiction. National commission doesn't have the pecuniary jurisdiction below 10 crores. But there is only one exception to it. Under Section 35(1)(c) of the Consumer Protection Act 2019, a joint complaint can be filed by several persons claiming similar reliefs. So if the complaint is being filed by, say, 5 persons, and they are the allottees or the purchasers of a project of a real estate which has, say, 1 tower, and it has about, say, 100 or 200 flats, right? And each purchaser has paid, say, 10 lakhs for nominal amount. So 10 lakhs in a joint complaint will be added for each consumer, and then the figure will come to more than 10 crores. So the joint complaint will be maintainable at the national commission. Similar is the case where the value will come to less than 10 crores, but rupees one more than 1 crore, then the state commission will be having the power to entertain joint complaint under 35(1)(c).
And what about e-filings, sir? Do you think district forums are now equipped to handle e-filings?
E-filings, the district forums have started. Of course, the infrastructure, it will be built up, but e-filing has started in many of the state commissions and also in the district forums.
Right, sir. Last question, because I think we are running out of time for both the current panelists. I'm referring to Section 87(1), which is the exception to product liability action. On a plain reading, sir, I'll just read out for the benefit of audience. A product liability action cannot be brought against the product seller if at the time of harm the product was misused, altered, or modified. Now, this is a very general sort of a defense which can be abused by the product manufacturer in almost, to my understanding, this would be the most commonly used defense when we will see cases like this. What is the quality of evidence that the consumer forums would be looking at when deciding these disputes?
This is a provision which gives the power to the product manufacturer to say that I am not liable because the product has not been used as per the directions given. It has been mixed up by the user. Something has been mixed up or modified or altered, whatever you may say. But I would give an example. If you file a suit, then you file a plaint before this in a civil suit before the civil judge. In the written statement, normally the defendant takes 4 objections. 1, it is barred by limitation. No cause of action has arisen, misjoinder of parties, non-disclosure of material facts, concealment, right? So all these things are taken, though not provided in the act, right? But they are taken, the civil court decides on this issue on the basis of evidence and material record. So this is an enabling provision which gives a power to the manufacturer of the product to say that I'm not liable for X, Y, Z reason. It has been specifically included. And if this plea is taken, then the consumer for us will have to deliberate on it, give a finding on the basis of evidence recorded and material produced.
Therefore, sir, in other words, the burden of proof will be on the product manufacturer when he is taking this defense.
That's it.
Ultimately, it would be his word against the consumer. Mr. Basu, would you like to add something to this, sir?
Yes, I think my answer would be similar. It is on the weight of the evidence, because always, you know, the preponderance and as to the weight of the evidence that would determine, and there has to be an adjudication by the concerned commission, whether there's a district commission, state commission, or national commission, on the material which is before it. And and that's what I was emphasizing, that the beauty of the act is that there are very stringent provisions, but they are not draconian in any manner, right? So it gives an equal opportunity to both the manufacturer as well as the consumer, right? So if the manufacturer is at fault, then he will be penalized. But if the manufacturer, the fault which is being highlighted was not intentional in any way, or was by introduced by an escape clause or an exit clause, if I may say, which is permissible under the statute, like we talked of the endorser making due diligence inquiries and then trying his best to elicit information, and whatever information he gets, he acts on it, right? So therefore, there is a checks and balance which gives equal opportunity to the sites concerned to put forward their cases, and that adjudication is to be finally made by the commission as to who is at fault or not.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I understand there are many more questions coming in, and with the implementation of this act, with various judicial pronouncement of NCDRC and Honorable Supreme Court in due course, there will be further more questions. I'm sure we can do a sequel of this webinar sometime soon. I'm extremely grateful to Honorable Justice R.K. Agarwal and Mr. Joy Basu for accepting my invitation for this enlightening conversation. I'm sure the audience were benefited and enlightened the same way as much as we enjoyed listening to these two distinguished speakers. Over to Dr. Vahini and Neelu Vyas for a vote of thanks. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Shashank. Thank you so much. And it was really an enlightening session. And after listening to all of you and the kind of question and answer session there was, I can definitely say that it seems that a completely new era of consumer rights is going to usher in. And especially with Justice R.K. Agarwal, with the way he addressed so many concerns. And yes, I must say that we need not worry as far as the consumer rights are concerned. Now I invite Dr. Varsha Vahini to give a word of thanks to our august panelists.
Thank you, Neeluji. I have this honor of summing up and extending vote of thanks to all our panelists. Before I extend a formal thank you note to everyone, I would like to say that since a Consumer Protection Act has brought in structural changes to bring about paradigm shift in the consumer jurisprudence in the times to come, not only students but also teachers like us who are teaching Consumer Protection Act have to unlearn and relearn many things in the wake of new legislation. Another thing, when we were talking about the coordinate jurisdiction of different authorities, probably it would not be wrong to mention the jurisdiction of Competition Commission of India too. To some extent, CCI also has exercised jurisdiction on the complaints filed by the consumers. As far as some of the builders or housing issues have arisen, though of late, Competition Commission of India has restrained itself from exercising or giving any orders or relief in such issues. Thank you very much, Justice R.K. Agarwal, for sparing your time and being with us. And, very meticulously, you have explained the previous legislation and also what were the drawbacks, what were the weaknesses, what were the difficulties which were, being faced in implementation of the previous legislation, and how new legislation would, address those issues. Thank you very much for, coming and speaking to us on this very, very pertinent, topic. Again, I would like to thank Mr. Joy Basu also for, giving, about the new legislation, strengths and weaknesses, and how it will help in bringing about paradigm shift in the consumer jurisprudence. Thank you very much, Neelu ma'am. Thank you very much, Shashank ji, for joining in this session. Thank you, audience, for listening to this very, very interesting webinar and taking very, very important points with you in the coming times. Thank you very much. Thank you once again.
Thank you, Varshaji. Thank you. And we'd just like to remind the audience that Suviksha, stay tuned to the Suviksha platform. Our website is www.suviksha.com. And on 20th of this month, we are going to hold another webinar, which is on the construction law. So all those who are interested and who would be watching this webinar, so there's a simple request, if you could register yourself, very soon we'll be putting out more details. Thank you all of you for joining in this evening.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Thank you for having us all. Thank you.